Hello everyone, welcome back to Act of Learning. This will be the second video in our series on rectification of curves. In the first video of this series, we saw how Torricelli was able to calculate the arc length of a logarithmic spiral. Somewhat unsurprisingly, the next curve to be rectified was probably the only curve that could rival the logarithmic spiral in terms of mathematical beauty. And that distinction belongs to the cycloid. The cycloid is a curve traced by a point on the circumference of a circle rolling on a straight line. This curve has fascinated many mathematicians throughout history. We also did an earlier video in our channel, finding the area under the cycloidal arch. Mathematicians, including Pascal, Roberval, Torricelli, and Huygens, came up with different ideas for calculating the arc length of a cycloid. The first published proof of the cycloid's arc length was given by Christopher Wren, a renowned architect and one of the founding members of the Royal Society. Wren's geometrical proof was based on approximating the curve with smaller and smaller segments tangential to the cycloid. He then proceeded to find a relation between these segments and a particular tangent to that cycloid. Though this simple geometrical proof is of historical importance, we will see a proof that is more elegant and in the spirit of Archimedes. We know that the cycloid is a curve formed by a point on the circumference of a rolling circle. But taking an idea from Archimedes, let's study the curve traced by a vertex of a regular polygon rolling on a straight line. For example, here's how the curve looks like when a square rolls on a straight line. And this is how the curve would look like when we roll a pentagon. To preserve the scale of the cycloid, we resize the regular polygons such that they can be inscribed in a circle of radius 1. As the number of sides increases, the curve so formed starts to approximate a cycloid. By the time we reach a 20-sided regular n-gon, the resulting curve is almost indistinguishable from a cycloid. Because the almost cycloids are made up of circular arcs, it will be easy to write an expression for their arc lengths. We'll work with the hexagon in this video to get a feel of what the expression for the almost cycloid's arc length looks like. The cycloid formed from rolling a hexagon is made up of 5 circular arcs. It is easy to see that the radius of these arcs are the distances of the vertices from a specific vertex of the hexagon, and each of these arcs span an angle of 2 pi by 6 radians. But the vertex-to-vertex distances of a regular n-gon inscribed in a unit circle is simple geometry. As each side spans an angle of 2 pi by n radians, two vertices separated by k sides span an angle of 2k pi by n. Since this line is also a chord on a circle of radius 1, simple trigonometry shows us that the distance between two vertices separated by k sides is twice sine of k pi by n. Putting this all together, the total arc length of the almost cycloid for a hexagon becomes the sum of 2 sine k pi by 6 times 2 pi by 6 over all k. That is, each of the radius multiplied by the respective angles. Ideally, the sum should run from 1 to 5, but adding terms on either side doesn't change the result but simplifies the formula later. Generalizing this expression for an arbitrary n is an easy job. all the sixes staring at us in this expression are present here because of our choice of an hexagon. Thus, the arc length of an almost cycloid for a regular n-gon is straightforward. We just replace the sixes by the n's. To find the arc length of a cycloid, we need to evaluate this sum as n tends to infinity. There are multiple beautiful ways to do this. One method is to note that the sum at infinity equals the integral of sine pi x from 0 to 1. But as we are actively avoiding calculus in this series and seeing the arc length from a historical standpoint, let's go via a more direct route that was available to the 17th century mathematicians. We make use of Lagrange's trigonometric identity, which gives a closed form expression for a sum of sines of angles in arithmetic progression. From there, we have a simple form for the sum that we are trying to evaluate. Finding the limit of this expression is simple. Both the sine terms in the numerator becomes 1 as n tends to infinity. Manipulating the resulting expression and using the famous small angle approximation for the sine function, we finally see that the value of L infinity here is 8. As we know that L infinity represents the cycloid's arc length, we see that the arc length of a full cycloid is 8 times the radius of a generating circle. What I find really interesting with this proof is that all the ideas involved are completely elementary. In fact, the same idea can be used to prove that the area under the cycloidal arch is 3 times that of its generating circle. Hope you enjoyed the discussion. See you in the next video.